Jacob's life began with adversity. He jostled for position in the womb with Esau and was born clutching his brother's heel. The name Jacob translates as "he deceives." When his mother, Rebekah, asked God what was wrong with her during her pregnancy, God told her that there were two nations within her womb that would be divided. One would be stronger than the other, with the older serving the younger. Genesis 25:23, "And the Lord said unto her, Two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels, and the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger." Esau became a skilled hunter who enjoyed being out in nature, whereas Jacob was content to stay at home among the tents. Genesis 25:27-28, "And the boys grew, and Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field, and Jacob was a plain man, dwelling in tents. And Isaac loved Esau because he did eat of his venison, but Rebekah loved Jacob." Esau was his father's favorite because Isaac loved the wild game Esau brought home, whereas Jacob was favored by his mother. This destructive favoritism would be passed down through the family, most notably to Jacob's son Joseph. Jacob's favoritism for Joseph caused so much resentment among his brothers that it nearly cost Joseph his life. When Isaac was old and his eyesight faded, he thought he was near to his death and made arrangements with Esau to pass on to him the blessings due to the firstborn son. Genesis 27:1-4, "And it came to pass that when Isaac was old and his eyes were dim so that he could not see, he called Esau his eldest son and said unto him, My son. And he said unto him, Behold, here am I. And he said, Behold now, I am old, I know not the day of my death. Now therefore take, I pray thee, thy weapons, thy quiver, and thy bow, and go out to the field, and take me some venison, and make me savory meat, such as I love, and bring it to me, that I may eat, that my soul may bless thee before I die." When Rebekah heard this, she devised a scheme to trick Isaac into blessing Jacob instead. As a result, Jacob received his father's blessing in place of Esau. Esau vowed to kill Jacob as soon as the mourning period for his father's death ended. Genesis 35:27-29. "And Jacob came unto Isaac his father, unto Mamre, unto the city of Arba, which is Hebron, where Abraham and Isaac sojourned. And the days of Isaac were 180 years. And Isaac gave up the ghost, and died, and was gathered unto his people, being old and full of days. And his sons Esau and Jacob buried him." Rebekah, on the other hand, became aware of Esau's plan and warned Jacob. Rebekah also advised Isaac to find Jacob a wife from among his own people, so Isaac sent Jacob to his uncle Laban, who lived in their ancestral home of Haran. During Jacob's journey, he had a dream of a ladder to heaven with God at the top and angels ascending and descending. Genesis 28:10-22. Verse 10, "Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran." The account of Jacob's dream at Bethel is one of the most well-known Jacob stories, possibly even in the Bible. The 550-mile trip from Beersheba to Haran would have taken Jacob over a month. He travels north along the ridge road that goes through Hebron, Jerusalem, Bethel, and Shechem, then joins the main highway in the Jordan Valley and heads northeast toward Damascus. It will most likely take several days to travel 60 miles from Beersheba to Bethel. Verse 11, "When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth, with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it." His dream presents a ladder or stairway. In Mesopotamia, the comparable word to the one used here describes the stairway used by a messenger of the gods moving from one realm to another. At the same time, take note that Yahweh is not seen descending the stairway. Rather, he is seen standing beside it. Thus, the dream is deeply embedded in the imagery of the worldview that it depicts, but it is distinct in how God interacts with it. This is Jacob's first supernatural encounter with God, and it parallels Abraham's in Genesis 15. It's also worth noting that Jacob is nearly the same age as Abraham was when God told him to leave his home and travel to a new land. A ladder set up on the ground. This is more accurately described as a ramp or staircase. It is similar to a mound built against a walled city. 2 Samuel 20:15. Then they came and besieged him in Abel of Beth Makkah, and they cast up a siege mound against the city, and it stood by the rampart, and all the people who were with Joab battered the wall to throw it down. Jesus took this figure as a means of access between heaven and earth as a picture of himself. John 1:43-51. The following day, Jesus wanted to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." And Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered and said to him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered and said to him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Most assuredly, I say to you, hereafter you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." Genesis 28:13-17. There above it stood the Lord, and he said, "I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave until I have done what I have promised you." When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it." He was afraid and said, "How awesome is this place! This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven." At similar discoveries of the divine presence, Jacob was afraid. So were Job, Genesis 42:5-6, Isaiah, Genesis 6:5, Peter, Luke 5:8. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." Revelation 1:17-18. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead, and he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, "Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen, and have the keys of hell and of death." Genesis 28:18-22. Early the next morning, Jacob took the stone he had placed under his head and set it up as a pillar and poured oil on top of it. He called that place Bethel, though the city used to be called Luz. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, "If God will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking, and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear, so that I return safely to my father's household, then the Lord will be my God, and this stone that I have set up as a pillar will be God's house, and of all that you give me, I will give you a tenth." When Jacob wakes up, he has two reactions. First, he recognizes the nature of the location, which consists of three steps. He recognizes the sacredness of the location. Jacob recognizes the space as sacred space, a house of God, because he has seen a gateway here. Second, Jacob constructs a pillar out of the stone. Sacred pillars and standing stones were common in the ancient world's religious environment. Jacob names the location Bethel, which means house of God, thereby formalizing his new knowledge of the location. The text makes no mention of a city being present at the time of Jacob's visit. Jacob's second response is a personal one in the form of a vow. Vows are promises made with conditions, almost always to God. Although sacrifices are not mentioned in Genesis 35, Jacob does build an altar, making it more likely that he fulfills this part of his vow through sacrifice. However, there was a more intangible component to Jacob's promises. The Lord, Yahweh, will be my God. It is not by chance that Jacob uses the more generic Elohim in his situation. However, in verse 21, he specifically mentions Yahweh as his God. In other words, if Providence smiles on him and returns Jacob to this land, as he has promised, he will recognize that Yahweh is behind that providence and is guiding his destiny. As Christians, we see this dream of Jacob's as highly symbolic, representing the mediator, Jesus Christ, who came to earth and became that ladder or stairway for us to reconnect the relationship with God that was severed because of sin. Romans 5, 1 and 2 says, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith unto this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God." According to the Bible, Jesus was our ideal Jacob's ladder, who came to earth from the line of Jacob through God's provision and redeemed us so that we could live in heaven for all eternity. Jacob's reaction to this vision suggests that on this occasion he may have become a true believer. The symbols for a memorial and consecration are typically a pillar and oil. Deuteronomy 27, 2-4. "And it shall be on the day that ye shall pass over Jordan unto the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, that thou shalt set thee up great stones, and plaster them with plaster. And thou shalt write upon them all the words of this law, when thou art passed over, that thou mayest go in unto the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, a land that floweth with milk and honey, as the Lord God of thy fathers hath promised thee. Therefore it shall be, when ye be gone over Jordan, that ye shall set up these stones, which I command you this day, in Mount Ebal, and thou shalt plaster them with plaster." Isaiah 19:19. "In that day there will be an altar to the Lord in the midst of the land of Egypt, and a pillar to the Lord at its border." The later forbidden pillars were associated with Baal worship and the objects of that worship. Deuteronomy 12:3, "And you shall destroy their altars, break their sacred pillars, and burn their wooden images with fire. You shall cut down the carved images of their gods, and destroy their names from that place." Micah 5:13, "Your carved images I will also cut off, and your sacred pillars from your midst, and you shall no more worship the work of your hands. I will surely give you the tenth." It was a voluntary act on Jacob's part. God had not commanded it. This is similar to Genesis 14:20, where Abram's tenth to Melchizedek was also voluntary. Genesis 14:20, "And blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand, and he gave him a tithe of all." It was not a requirement until the law was given to Israel, and then two tithes were to be given, not one, as many assume, the annual tithe for the maintenance of the Levites, and one for the Lord's feast. Numbers 18:21, "And behold, I have given the children of Levi all the tenth in Israel for an inheritance, for their service which they serve, even the service of the tabernacle of the congregation." It may be that every third year the second tithe was not brought to the sanctuary, but was kept at home and used to feed the Levites and the poor, according to Deuteronomy 14:28-29. Deuteronomy 14:28-29. "At the end of 3 years thou shalt bring forth all the tithe of thine increase the same year, and shalt lay it up within thy gates. And the Levite, because he hath no part nor inheritance with thee, and the stranger, and the fatherless, and the widow, which are within thy gates, shall come, and shall eat and be satisfied. That the Lord thy God may bless thee in all the work of thine hand which thou doest. If not, then there was a third tithe every third year." Thus, a consistent Israelite might give 23 1/3% annually, plus offerings for sin, and so forth. Jacob's dream emphasizes God's initiating grace by assuring him that he is the Lord of both the past and the future, not because he was righteous, but because of God's call and faithfulness to Abraham. Jacob was the third generation to receive the promises of the Abrahamic covenant. Because Jacob had most likely never heard God's voice before, the Lord identified himself through Abraham and Isaac.
In closing, our question for the day: what's a worship song that has helped you feel closer to God?